Okay. Afternoon, everybody. My name is Daniel Drake, and I am a professional pancake artist with the company Dan Cakes. And this is the second installment of our new live session series called The Joy of Pancakes. Now, The Joy of Pancakes is it was a YouTube series that we tried for a couple of episodes, and we decided, after seeing the amount of editing it took and how easy it was to put the stuff out versus how simple the concept is, that we were going to take a crack at starting to do more of a live streaming format. And so that's what I'm doing right now. So if you're just tuning in, please leave me a comment in the chat. We are using Restream, so this is going to multiple platforms, so you might see me respond to people on different platforms than you, but whenever I respond, I'm going to do my best to read the comment that I'm reading and the person and the platform they're saying it on, and then respond to it. So let's see. We've already got a couple comments over on YouTube. Adrian Ramirez says hi. Aliens are cool says hello. Pearl Cower says heyo. How are you doing? It's nice to hear from you, Pearl. It's nice to see you, to have you all here hanging out with us. I'm doing okay. I'm doing okay. I haven't been taking super good care of my sleep schedule lately, so I'm a little low key. But very fortunately, the Joy of Pancakes is a pretty low key thing. So on Facebook, we have Donald Wolverton Jr. asking, will you be doing some good patriotic pancakes for Patriots Day? And Trisha Killian says hi. Donald, that's a great question. I don't know if you guys saw that I named this video, or I said that the initial prompt that I'm going to be using for this episode of The Joy of Pancakes is freedom. It's a little bit ham-fisted, I guess, maybe. What I've been trying to do is, when I start one of these live sessions, I come up with a prompt in advance, and that's what I name the video. And then after I make the first pancake, I take prompts from people in the chat. But obviously today is September 11th, and it's certainly here in the United States, it's a big deal, and it's a big deal to a lot of people. It's the day that the 9/11 terrorist attacks in 2001 happened, and you know, it's definitely something that you remember where you were when that happened, and lots of things changed that day. And the thing is there's a whole lot of polarity, like a lot of conflict and argument in the world right now, and a lot of people have a lot of different opinions. And my job, I don't feel like, is to wade into a political debate on the Joy of Pancakes of all things. I decided to go with freedom because I felt like freedom is a philosophical concept that a lot of Americans are very emotionally attached to, but also I think we could spend a little bit more time thinking about what it actually means, about what freedom is. forgive me for making this pancake art show into a freaking philosophy hour. I'm kind of doing my best here. But yeah, I was thinking about the concept of freedom more than just American freedom, but like freedom as a human spiritual concept, like the ability to exist in the world and be free to be who you are, to love who you want to love, to follow your passions. And I think that there's a lot of people that don't feel they can do that right now, anywhere in the world. I mean, all over the world, you have a lot of people that are struggling. And a lot of scary things happening in the news. And at the same time, I feel like, in my mind, my concept of freedom is such that I feel like I could theoretically cultivate a sense of freedom if I was a political prisoner or something. Like, I feel like freedom is more about perspective and the freedom of the spirit. I don't know. I'm not gonna talk too much more about that. I'm just gonna get into trying to come up with some kind of a design that matches that abstract concept. And then, you know, please feel free to comment and hang out with me. I see we've got some more comments coming in. We've got Janice Witt on Facebook says hi. Kelly McPeak says so excited. Michaela, hey Michaela, it's good to see you too. Hello. Chocolate Boom on YouTube said something that looks like it's in Cyrillic. So Almer Benort says hello. Kaya Na Corey says hi. Almer Benort, love pancakes. I love pancakes too. Appreciate you saying stuff, everybody. Feel free to continue to give me feedback and opinions and all that stuff, but I'm just going to get into it. I think I've done a nice little intro here, and we're just going to dive right in. Freedom. What is freedom, right? And I think I've got an idea in my head of what I'm going to draw. See if you can guess, follow along. Let's see. Where am I going to start? Now, if you have never seen pancake art done before, because I know not everybody that's tuning in is a Dan Cakes fan. Some people stumble upon this stuff sort of just because of the algorithm or whatever. What I'm actually doing here is I'm drawing with pancake batter. All the colors that I have in the bottles in front of my griddle here are colored pancake batter. There's a consistency of plain batter that I'll mix up at the beginning of a session, and then I add what's called gel colors or icing gels to each bottle, and then I shake them up. You don't need a lot. Gel colors are cool because they're very potent, so I only need about 2 drops of red to get something, and this is really more of a pink, but it's still a lot better than regular food coloring would give you. And so all of these are raw pancake batters that have been colored, and I'm drawing directly onto the surface of the griddle. And it's also, I think I'd like to note that the griddle is not on. That's something else a lot of people get a little bit perturbed by, as they see there's a different method of pancake art called heat toning, where you actually use the heat of the griddle to create contrast by sort of scorching your designs. And that's not the method I use. So it's a very that's a very tricky method to do really, really well. But so I'm drawing with the griddle off. And what I'm trying to do right here is I'm trying to sort of build up a tree. A nice little pine tree. I'm just trying to do some textured lines. One of the other big things I try to tell folks when I'm making pancake art. Oh, sorry, I just forgot something. I did this stream yesterday. I told myself I wasn't going to do this. I did this on Wednesday. Wednesday was the very first time I'd done this Joy of Pancakes Live, and I was like, oh, right, I should put some chill music on. Give me one second. I'm going to go over to this little laptop here and figure out how I can. We have a mod that does music and stuff, and I'm probably going to be doing this for a little while, so we don't want it to be completely dead silent the whole time. Bear with me. I apologize, folks. How do I do this? Let me see. Goodness gracious. I've never had to do this before. It's kind of a... Let's see. And some chill out. Oh, and this is all just songs. Playlists, stations. Gosh, there. Let's try that. Sorry, y'all. There we go. All right. That was actually easier than I thought it would be. So let me go ahead and come back to what I was doing. Sorry, I'm back. Laura PM on Facebook says, hola. Kelly McPeak on Facebook says, I'm a fan cake. Thanks for hanging out, y'all. Appreciate that. Okay, I got a little distracted there. I'm still learning. I'm still learning how to do this stuff, run these streams by myself. Let me see. I was drawing this tree. I'm trying to come up with freedom. Freedom as a concept, right? Strange concept to try and draw. How would you draw freedom? feel like for a lot of Americans, they just do a bald eagle or something. But I want to get somewhere deeper than that. Let's see. I've got this tree. I know I'm going to cut off my design over here. Like, I don't want to... Just kind of sketching it out over there. I don't really want to go too much past that line. Don't want to make my pancake too enormous. Hey, it's AJ. How are you, AJ? It's good to see you. Thanks for dropping in, my friend. I was, before I distracted myself to get those musical tunes set up, I was about to explain the process of squeeze control, right? So all the batter I'm using has already been colored and it's all pancake mix. It's gonna be cooked on this griddle after I finish drawing all this stuff. But one of the techniques that I use to get really fine detail lines like I'm getting right here is called squeeze control. And when I say that, what I mean is before I turn this bottle over to start drawing, I squeeze just a tiny, tiny little bit of air out, just like that. And then I pivot upside down, and that creates suction that makes it so that I can start and stop my lines just with like tiny little fluctuations in the pressure I'm applying. It takes a lot of practice to get really good at, but I've had a lot of practice. And it's one of the things that helps take your pancake art to the next level. Okay, we're gonna do some gnarled roots. I have this tree sitting on a boulder. Don't want to make this too big. But, nice tree in the foreground. I think I have a horizon way off. Basically giving myself a canvas here, right? I sketch this line around. That way I don't make my pancake too enormous. I've got a nice hard edge. I don't want to make it much bigger than that. That'd be beautiful. AJ, it's good to hear that. I'm glad you're doing well. Becca Roberts on Facebook. It's good to hear from you, Becca. I'm glad you tuned in. Still working on school stuff, I presume? Maybe, maybe not. Let me see. I'm gonna do... How do I do that? It's interesting when you're trying to, like, freestyle something completely off the top of your head, because... I feel like I'm... kind of... trying to do sort of a cartoony representation of some of the visuals I remember when a few years back my wife and I went to, I got to go to Yellowstone National Park, and it was a good time of year, and we spent a week there hiking and exploring, and honestly, it was a magical, magical place. It's really a place where you get a chance to experience some of the most profound natural beauty that probably exists on the planet. It's all very... What's the word I'm looking for? I think one of the things that really struck me about Yellowstone was that the park itself changes a lot because it's so volcanic, because there's like new thermal features and stuff that just spring up, and part of what you read on all the placards talking about the things that you can visit is just talking about how this wasn't there in 1972, or the famous Old Faithful geyser has like changed its eruption patterns ever so slightly, that sort of thing. Like, I think that's one of the really fascinating things, because I think when you go to a national park, usually, you don't usually think about the fact that this entire landscape around you is in a constant state of change. And so when I think about the concept of freedom, I think a lot about the natural world. I think about nature. I think about the way that things tend to just flow into new forms over time. Check in the comments here. Hi, Kaya. How you doing? Yellowstone is very cool. RD, three people here. From where I'm sitting, we've got about 32, but that's, I think most folks are tuned in over on Facebook. We're using Restream, so a lot of folks. Paul Lurie, the music makes me so relaxed. I'm really glad to hear that. I tried to find something that would be relaxing, so. I can't actually hear the music from where I'm sitting, because it's, you know, we try to keep the audio controlled in here. But I wanna have mountains way back here. Kind of try to go through the Bob Ross school of thought when it comes to doing landscape stuff, which is sort of that, like, it's my landscape. I don't have to make it obey rules. I don't have to worry about, like, painting something appropriately. If I want to put some jagged edges on a cliff face over here, it's my art. So I'm going to go ahead and do that, because I feel like it. Ridge over here, almost like maybe this is up on a hill or a cliff, and down here is further away. I could really exemplify that if I put like a house down here, or like a little hut, a little shack, something down here to really exemplify the fact that it's far away. Woman's down there. Path leading to the front door there. We'll see how it turns out. The Noodle Princess is tuned in over on Twitch. Hey there. Thanks for dropping in again. It's always good to see you. Appreciate that. One thing that you'll see me do on when I do, I've been cultivating sort of a style for these Joy of Pancakes videos, because I use a limited palette, so I only have so much I can do, but I also have a lot of time to do stuff with it. So I've started to I do a lot of texture lines, you know, rather than trying to mix every color perfectly. I will stylize the heck out of things, like, do these really, really tiny lines as, like, shadow or ridges or something, you know. It's very... It gives me a chance to flow through things and just kind of repeat a stroke over and over again all the way down the side of the shape. And get sort of this really satisfying visual fingerprint when you take your time and do stuff like this. Let's see. I'm going to do a similar thing to the water here. I'm going to go across and create these little texture lines that sort of like a little placid lake. And I guess it's not that placid, there's a waterfall dumping into it. But I think about the concept of freedom with landscapes and stuff too, because there's something really inviting, I think, about seeing a beautiful vista in front of you and just just sort of marveling at how fantastic it is to live in the world, that a world that has stuff like this that you can see. What am I gonna do in the sky? I know what I'll do. I'll do just a couple of birds. Birds are great symbols of freedom, right? Three is a bird. Just a couple. Don't need more than maybe three. And then I'm gonna go ahead and do a big old sun. Trisha Killian on Facebook asks, have you always drawn? I have drawn for, yeah, I mean, more or less. Can't necessarily remember if I drew when I was real little, but I do remember being at least like 8 or 9 and like tracing all the Pokemon from the Scholastic Book Fair Pokemon Pokedex you could buy. There's the one elf. All the kids wanted that. And I would be one of the kids that would trace the Pokemon on tracing paper and ink them and color them in and try to sell them to my classmates. I don't know. It's just funny how that stuff grows and changes with you to where, like, I'm basically still doing something similar. Like, I'm still drawing stuff and trying to sell it to people. See if I can do some really, really cool texture on this sun. One thing I'm trying to do, and I don't know if you can see it, is I'm trying to figure out where the center of the shape is so that all my lines are pointing towards that invisible center. It gives you a little bit, it gives you good guidelines for all your little detail lines. Kaya on YouTube asks, is there a river? I kind of sort of made the river, like, there would be a river up this way that hits that cliffside and a waterfall comes down and there's a little lake. And I guess maybe there would be a drainage out behind this tree, but there's a tree in the way, so I didn't really articulate that too much. But that's a good question. I might go back and find a different way to articulate the drainage for that lake. See. Oh, got a bit of a clog. That's no good. There we go. I got it to clear. I don't know if y'all could hear that. AJ, you did the same tracing too? Yeah. It was the Pokemon style is actually... I've ended up making a lot of Pokemon pancakes. Because it's still popular, and because the style of the illustrations actually lends itself really, really easily to pancake art. They are both simple, like they have really simple line art, but then they use a lot of different colors in their shading zones, but the zones are very explicitly designated, so it's pretty easy to use pancake art and get fairly close to the way the Pokemon actually look. Funny how, like, I started drawing Pokemon and now I still draw Pokemon, and I guess this is just being a child of the 90s. That's such a millennial job, you know? It occurs to me that if I don't add another bird or two, that looks like a weird face. That's a little bit less uncanny. They still do the Scholastic Book Fair, huh? Watching the conversation unfold over on Facebook. Folks are talking about how they still do the Scholastic Book Fair. I'm glad I wasn't the only one that remembered that. I remember the one that... It wasn't just the Pokemon, the Pokedex. It was... there was a... The other one that all the kids wanted was... someone published a book that was... I think it was How to Draw Manga or How to Draw Anime. Right? And this was like around the time that Toonami and Adult Swim and Dragon Ball Z and all that stuff were being introduced to all the kids my age. And I remember getting that. I remember that being like a prized possession. Everybody was like, oh, can I borrow it? The How to Draw books were always super popular in the library, and I remember using those to do cool, fun stuff. Learning about how cartoonists use like basic shapes and build them up. Good days. Right now what I'm kind of doing is I'm going back over a lot of my line art and highlighting it. I'm not really worried too much about any kind of perfection, right? Because this is all freestyle. This is all off the top of my head. And what I've found, certainly with the more I've done these Joy Pancakes videos, is that the cool thing about using black line work and then going back over with these stark white highlights is that that contrast really makes those shapes stand out. It really makes them pop. And you know what I'm going for, you know? More than the realism, it's a very sort of pop art sensibility, like a sort of really about strong shapes more than it is about proper colors and soft lines and all that stuff. But we'll see. I haven't really done one that's quite so... Oh, I've got another clog. Quite so elaborate. There we go. Alright. Let's see. Do a couple of little texture lines here for... I'm just going to assume that there's grass out here. Not really sure how this is going to turn out. I think it'll be okay. Let's see. Michaela on Facebook says, my high school art teacher would flip if she saw you do black outlines. She always told us to use dark colors, but not black. I still did. I've heard that too. I've heard a lot of very like professionally trained, you know, actually went to school for it, fine artists say that black is not, you never really see true black in the real world when you really think about it. Everything is always cast in shades of all the colors that are around it. So you'll have really, really dark blues and really, really dark browns. But also, I don't care. I am the least pretentious artist you're gonna find because I didn't go to school for anything, much less art. I didn't take any real classes. I just do my best. That's basically my entire approach to art is, I'll do my best. I'll see what I can pull off. I'll see if I can make something look all right. And there's no category in my brain for, you know, like technical expert. You know how they talk about musicians with music theory, and I do music too, and I'm the same way with music, where like it's just language, right? Like, babies can learn how to talk. And I think we get it in our heads, certainly in society. Society gets it in society's head, that there is a right way and a wrong way to speak, and a right way and a wrong way to draw, and a right way and a wrong way to think. And, you know, I mean, this is all very relevant to the prompt of freedom. Like, is there a right way and a wrong way to communicate? I think if you get your point across and you enjoy doing it, then you have communicated. That if you are able to, if somebody's able to look at a drawing you do and recognize, oh, yeah, that's a forest scene. Yeah, that's a river. Then you have done communication. And if somebody wants to come by and come up with a rhetorical framework to say, well, objectively, this is far superior as a piece of art because it's like, okay, I mean, you know, you can think that, you can have those reasons and stuff, but also it would be super cool if you didn't tie children's sense of self-worth to how much they can fulfill those expectations you have. That's where it gets really messy, right? Because then you have entire generations of people who walk around under the impression that they aren't artists, that they aren't creative, that they can't draw. And I don't personally subscribe to the idea that anybody can't draw. I think if you are capable of holding a pencil and understand how to put it to the paper, that you in fact are capable of drawing. And at that point, it's just a matter of how much shame you feel in your ability to draw like everybody says you should. I think that's why there's a lot of very famous artists out there who drew and painted in such a way that you don't need to sit and study human anatomy for 12 years to make the kind of art they made. And they had brilliant careers, and they did these crazy things with color and shapes. I think about Basquiat or Keith Haring. There's artists who exclusively work in stencils, right? Like, they cut images out and do like spray paint over them. And, you know, I mean, it really depends on what you teach kids to think of art as. If you think art is just, are you able to use a pen or a pencil to perfectly render an image of a butterfly? Well, then of course you're going to sort of gatekeep some people that maybe it doesn't come as naturally to them. Maybe they need more practice. Maybe their brain doesn't see the world the same way. But I think it's far worse for the world to teach those people that they aren't artists than it is to empower them and say, well, these are just guidelines, not rules. I don't know, there's something really heartbreaking about, I've done pancake art classes before. Like, I've been hired by public schools to come and do like, these kids, you know, won the freaking, they sold the most pizzas or whatever, and so they get a special treat, which is, you know, we're gonna have Dan Cakes come in and do a pancake art class. And there's one that stands out in particular in my mind. It was over in Illinois, and I think one of the first people, like, the way it worked is we mixed up the colors and showed people an example and then asked the kids to come up and give it a shot on their own and say, all right, we got the colors, we got everything here, and we showed you the basics, come give it a shot. There's just something really sad about seeing, you know, a freaking middle school girl seem really excited about something, about getting a chance to do it, and then getting up and standing by the griddle and holding the bottle and paralyzing because she realizes that everybody's looking at her and she's not going to do it good, right? Not going to do it good. You're going to do bad art. And it's like, I don't care if you can. I don't care if you come up with a system to measure art objectively. Whatever you want to do with that, that's fine. But, like, people should be empowered to mess up. You know? Like, because that's how you get good. That's how you get good at stuff. And we've got such a weird relationship with shame in the world. It makes me sad. It's like, let's change that. Let's like, I would much rather have the rules of art completely thrown away and everybody making chaotic art than it be this thing that's just like, oh, you go to school for that. I didn't go to school. I couldn't afford the frickin' $90,000 tuition to have some guy tell me that my drawing wasn't good enough. Like, it's, I put it like that, it's kind of funny, right? sorry, I haven't been checking the chat there. I see a couple folks are interacting with some of the stuff I said. Kelly McPeak on Facebook says, I heard Ben Folds once say he encouraged kids to doodle before they can draw, so why not tell them to bang on keyboards? It's just musical doodling. And yeah, exactly. That's exactly right. And it's amazing, there's so much crossover between music and drawing that people don't, it's really subtle. A lot of people think that they're completely separate, but the things I was talking about earlier about how it's like, fundamentally, it's just communicating, right? Like, you know that feeling you get when you listen to Get Lucky by Daft Punk or something? Like, music is literally just finding how to communicate that emotional resonance. And you don't need to know what a major chord is to do that. You just need to hit the buttons on the keyboard until you're like, oh yeah, that's it. What else we got? Michaelia says, I teach paint and sip sessions, and almost every single person who walks through the door says, I am no artist, this is gonna turn out horrible. Yeah, it's an epidemic. It's like a spiritual thing. It's all related. I am going to do something very strange with the rays of this sun. I'm basically gonna use my brown to create this sort of deep contrast. You know, the sun doesn't emit brown light, but I like the stylized idea of having stripes around it, you know? We'll see how it turns out. Contrast is one of the big things I try to emphasize when I'm teaching people how to do like pancake art, because you can draw any shape you want as long as you get enough contrast. Let's see, here's what I'll do. Red. Orange. Yellow. I'm just gonna go with the yellow because I believe that the yellow is gonna be brighter. I'm just gonna fill that all the way in with the yellow. That's nice. And then I've got my red, my orange, and my yellow. What I'm gonna do is I'm gonna do red or yellow, orange, red, yellow, orange, red, yellow, orange, red. Oops. Yellow, orange, red, yellow, orange, red, yellow, orange, red, yellow, yellow, orange, red. Just a nice little pattern. Just something I can kind of come back to. And all the rest of them will do red. And we'll see how that fireball of a sun looks. A lot of colors, huh? Let's see. Trisha Killian on Facebook says, I can understand that. I was a cake decorator for years and I free-handed some of the cakes. One in particular was a Mario Bros. Cake for a little boy whose mom's battling cancer. She cried and it will stick with me forever. Even now that I'm a stay-at-home mom, I do cakes for people who can't afford to buy one. I get to help them and keep up with my love of decorating. That's really beautiful, Trisha. Thank you for sharing that. That's really wonderful. And I imagine it's fulfilling, right? Like, not only, you know, people say working with your hands is a fulfilling thing, but like, working with your hands to craft something unique that you can give to somebody else that has an emotional impact, it's just, the fact, just, I'm speechless about it. You know, being able to do that with pancake art is such a strange, bizarre blessing. And yeah, so I know firsthand how amazing it feels to be able to do it. It's worth it, you know? It is its own reward. Let's see if I can get some shading on this here. Rock wall. I'm using brown shading, but I'm going to be coloring a lot of this stuff in with gray because I think it is like stone. Maybe I'll use some green. There's usually some green on mountaintops and stuff, right? Clip size. Yeah, let's throw some green in there. AJ says, I've got to get ready for my meet and greet. As always, it's a pleasure to see your art, my friend. Until next time, I appreciate you dropping in. And I will, we'll be doing this again. I'm doing another live Joy of Pancakes on Monday at 3 p.m. Central Daylight Time. So if you want to tune in then, hopefully I'll see you. Probably going to do one or two more pancakes after this one, too. Trisha says, thank you. It's an amazing feeling for me to do a baby shower cake, and then the first and second, etc. birthday cakes, and watch those kiddos grow up. Yeah, I bet. I bet that's a really special thing. Kaya on YouTube says, that is beautiful. I appreciate you saying so, Kaya. We'll see how this turns out. I've got a good feeling so far. I've noticed, like I was mentioning, that I have this sort of style that I've been cultivating with the Joy of Pancakes videos, the live ones in particular, where I try to come up with an excuse to use all the different colors I have. And it's not really... I don't know if it makes the most sense color-wise, you know, you'll have a lot of people that tell you, oh, that's not how you're supposed to do it, or it'll look better if you do this, and there's certainly some truth to that, you know, like I've done some really beautiful portrait pieces where I was very, very mindful of, like, the real subtle changes that happen in a design's color, and how you can really create, like, soft lighting, and there's all kinds of stuff you can do. But with something that's super stylized like this, there's almost like a different vibe, you know, like a different visual tonal effect that you get when you use just one tone each of all the colors in the rainbow. It's a very, it creates a distinctive look. It's a little cartoony, I think. Honestly, it's a little amateur, but I also think amateur things can be quite beautiful. And like I said in the title of the video, it's all about freedom today, so... What kind of a freedom video would it be if I wasn't just letting myself do whatever? Being free to experiment. See what happens. Outline that house in white just a little bit, just so it pops a little bit more. It's a very small shape, and I don't want it to get completely lost in the grass. And as for the grass, I think I'm going to do some light indigo texturing. Well, and one color I have not used yet is purple, so I'm going to have an excuse to use purple. Kaya on YouTube asked, can you do a sloth? I'm perfectly capable of doing a sloth, Kaya, and since you asked, if I can, and since that's the sort of thing that I could probably pull out of my brain, I'll take that into consideration for the pancake that I do after this one, if that sounds okay to you. I might throw a sloth on the griddle after this. Okay. All right. Almost there. I'm going to give this a nice little border, my white batter. I got my griddle turned on now. I'm going to cook this at about 225 degrees. That's not hot enough to burn it, but it's hot enough to cook all the raw batter. I don't want to make the pancake too much bigger than that, so I think I'll just leave that border. But then I'm going to take my plain batter, Oh, is this gonna pop on me? No, okay. Take my plain batter, and as this starts to cook, I'm gonna back it. I'm gonna give it a little bit of pancake batter on the back. And let's see. There we go. Lovely. I like doing those very controlled lines. Wella Kelly on YouTube asks, what happens when you back it too early? Well, first off, good to see you, Wella. And if I back it too early, well, it's that if I haven't used any heat yet to set the design, as it were, so if the griddle is completely cool, all the lines and pancake batter I put on the griddle will be liquid. And so if I put a whole bunch of liquid batter on top of other liquid batter, it has a tendency to like push it and smears it, you know, it makes it sort of bleed outwards and really changes. It can change your line work, it can change your fill work, all that stuff. So I like to set it with a little bit of heat before I start doing that, just so that it actually goes where I want it to. And you can see a little bit what I'm talking about with the bleeding. Right, like here, here, and that was even after I set it a little bit. So, you know, it's just sort of something I try to be mindful of. That was a good question, though, and I appreciate that you asked it. Trisha Killian over on Facebook says, you should preserve that one. I think I probably will. I don't know if y'all have been seeing the ones we have on the wall behind us. I'm not sure how many people are in the chat that haven't seen what we do at Dan Cakes, haven't seen some of the cool stuff we've been pulling off, but we have recently got our workshop up and running to where we're able to preserve pancake art now. And when we do that, we freeze dry it, we seal it, and we sink it into resin. We basically Hank builds these shallow frames on these things behind me. Let me pull one off the wall so I can show you a little bit. I was really proud of this one. This one was for the actor Chadwick Boseman passed away recently, and we made a tribute for him. And it's preserved for all time, sunk into tabletop resin. It's almost like it's suspended in glass. And I don't know. We were an events company before this pandemic happened, and so all the events stopped. And now we're trying to be an art company, and like a proper art company. And so I think a lot of the stuff that I make on the Joy of Pancakes is going to end up on this wall behind me, and if you guys find a piece that you really, really like, you'll probably be able to buy it. So, it looks like this is almost ready to flip. That camera should switch in just a moment, and when it does, it might flip. Might be flipping it too soon. We'll see. I'm not going to worry too much about it. How's everyone doing today? While I wait for this last one to flip, to cook through so I can flip it. Let me know in the chat how your day is going, how you've been feeling. Hopefully you haven't been spending too much time on social media, getting in arguments and stuff like I do. I'm very, very good at getting in social media arguments. But I'm also very good, I like to think, at connecting with people online, so I like to think it balances out. So on the overhead it is. Okay, I'm gonna flip this. This is, the prompt of this one was freedom. So here we go. 3, 2, 1. That gave me chills, y'all. That one is, wow. That is, a lot of those things I was trying out worked out pretty well, I think. I love that. I think that is a very beautiful piece. Wow, I didn't even think about it, but those purple splotches I was just throwing in there for effect, they look like wildflowers. That's how it works, man. Mistakes are delicious. Sometimes you try things out and it's just like, oh, that's about 3 or 4 times cooler than I kind of expected it to be. Yeah. I really, really like that. Thanks for all the encouragement in the comments there, folks. I appreciate that. I appreciate that very much. Wella, Shahaf, Pat Price, Sky Kid. Oh, Sky Kid. Hey, it's good to see you. That was a really... And look at how it sits on the plate perfectly. I feel like that is the appropriate pancake size and shape. Yeah, I'm really, really happy with that one. Freedom. Hey, Lauren. It's good to see you. My cousin Lauren is watching on YouTube. Trisha Killian on Facebook says, I hope you are still extremely proud of your work. I am. There are some pancakes that are better than others, but it's one of those things where I think part of what I love so much about this medium is that I don't know myself how it's going to look until I flip it over. Like, I'm not sure. I try things out. I see how the layering works, and I can't see the final until I've cooked and flipped it. There are some times where I flip it over and I'm disappointed. Like when I spend 45 minutes trying to draw Bill Hader's face and it looks like somebody else entirely. Check our YouTube for that one. But the sort of yin and yang to that is that sometimes I'll flip a pancake over like this one where it turned out better than I could have hoped. And there's no real way for me to describe the emotional feeling it gives me, especially on a day like today where, I mean, there's a lot to stress you out on the internet right now, and this just brightens my day up, you know? Makes me feel good about myself, makes me feel excited to have this preserved and hanging on the wall back here at some point. So, that's the first pancake of the stream. I have plenty of pancake batter over here, and when I did my first live stream Joy of Pancakes on Wednesday, I was sort of thinking that it would just be one, and then that would be it, because that's how we were filming it before we did it live. But then I realized that folks kind of want to keep hanging out, and honestly, I want to keep hanging out with folks. So what y'all can do for me, if you're listening, if you're having a good time, is give me some prompts. I know that we had a sloth recommendation earlier, but I like taking more than one idea and putting it together, you know? Let me see. Wella on YouTube says, a rest theme with sloth. Rest. Sloth is actually a really great one for a restful theme. That's a good point. I could use some freaking rest. Let me, Rejuvenation. There we go. That's what that piece can be called. Purple Anubis on Twitch says, I'm glad you decided to do more than one long-form pancake on the streams. Yeah, me too, Purple Anubis. I appreciate you saying that. Look up sloth. Rejuvenation. Sleepy. Oh, they're so freaking cute. Kaya on YouTube says, sloths are the best animals to me. They are very likable, right? There's very little to be like, oh goodness. They're like weird puppy dogs. Let's see if I can find a really good one that will give me a good, I don't need to copy the pose. I just need to see one's face pretty close. I wonder how closely related these things are to raccoons. Okay, I'm gonna do sloth. The Freaky Girl 32 on YouTube says, Baby Yoda, please. Hello from Germany. Hello, Guten Tag. I might work Baby Yoda into the next one after this, but I don't know if that would necessarily jibe with a restful sloth. But I appreciate you watching, I appreciate your suggestions, and I hope y'all keep it coming. This is the basic reference that I'm going to be going off of, so we'll see. Rejuvenation sloth. Sloth rejuvenations. First thing I think I want to do is... How am I going to do this? All right, let's just dive in. And those eye markings. Trying to match some of the color patterns on a sloth face. They have very domed heads. Videos is the Freaky Girl 32. I appreciate you saying so. Kaya says sloth in a forest. Willa says you need a setting. Yeah, I figured something out. I appreciate all the comments y'all are leaving. It's nice to have folks interested in what I'm doing. Do a lot of these dark strokes is a lot of fur. Sloths are very furry critters. And how many toes do they have? Three. Three-toed sloth toes. Find these tapered little texture lines to be extremely satisfying to draw. Let's see, how do those legs look? Oh gosh, they're so goofy. I got goofy legs because they wrap around all silly looking. Kind of like a... sloth butt. There we go. A lot of these texture lines. I think the texture lines are part of what makes these designs look as cool as they do with the limited palette, so... I think that's part of the reason I just love doing them so much, is that I know that if I do enough of them, it really communicates the furriness And it does it in such a way that it looks very stylized and cool. Trisha Killian on Facebook asks a very good question. Do you notice any difference in the consistency of regular batter and sugar-free? That's a really great question. Consistency is something that for the most part, you can control with the amount of liquid ingredients you add, whether it's regular or sugar-free or what have you. But I have definitely noticed that there are certain brands of pancake batter or certain types. Like, we use a buttermilk just add water mix. There are like non-buttermilk pancake mixes, and there's cake batter pancake mixes, and there's buckwheat pancake mixes, and all of them have their ups and downs, pitfalls, and that sort of thing. I have definitely noticed that when we use non-buttermilk pancake mixes, I guess it kind of depends on the brand, but sometimes there's this weird effect that'll happen where certain brands of pancake mix, they cook light, which is to say that I'll put a dark color of gel in the batter, and then when it cooks, it brightens the color, which is not usually what I want, especially if I'm putting it in a dark gel color. Because, like, the dark gel colors, I want them to be dark, you know? It's all about contrast. It's all about making it look the way that I want it to look, with dark lines and outlines. And so when the batter cooks it lighter, it makes it so it's almost like you can't see my line art, and it doesn't make it look very good. So I'm not sure if that has anything to do with the sugar free and I'm not sure how much that helps answer your question. Most recipes I've found, though, you can work around a lot of those limitations. All right, so we're gonna round this out, as I do with my Joy of Pancakes. It's not round enough. I'm gonna cheat. I'm gonna use my finger there. That's a little better. Kaya, good, just finished up my schoolwork. Awesome, I'm very glad to hear that, Kaya. It's always relieving to get your duties done for the day. Move on to more fun things, like watching pancake art. How am I gonna... This tree that I'm looking at is so... It's covered in moss and lichens and all kinds of stuff, and I kind of want to try and capture some of that. I don't want to overdo it with the black batter here, so see if I can just see if I can communicate these lichen moss ideas without making it cluttered and confusing. Trisha Killian on Facebook says, it does, thank you. Can't wait for my little dude to turn 6 months and dig into some. Neither can I. I hope that I've given you tips and that you're able to make some cool stuff. Rejuvenation. Right now it's just a sloth, and it's a sloth that's smiling. tree over here. I think what I'm going to do is I'm going to give this sloth some healing vibes. I always associate the color green with healing. So I'm going to make this sloth and these trees sort of illuminated. See if I can't do some more of those fancy lines I'm always talking to you guys about. Might end up being a little time consuming, but you know what? That just gives me more time to relax. This is going to be a weird effect. I was thinking about like writing the word chill or vibe or something, but I thought that would be a little bit corny. I think that this will be overall a prettier piece if I just kind of try to illustrate the vibe rather than write the vibe. If any of y'all want to make a meme out of the pancake and just write the word vibe on top of it, or mood, or whatever, that'd be cool. I'm starting to lose control of this bottle. I need to re-up my squeeze control real quick. Give me a second. Kaya says, how is it live, but I can pause you on YouTube? I mean, I think that it's because it's recording the video as I go. So, like, you can watch this later if you want to. I'm not positive how it actually does that. It's probably not that hard, but yeah, if you pause me, it doesn't stop being live. Like, I don't stop doing anything, but that way you don't miss anything. You know, I imagine that's probably what that's there for. Like, oh shoot, this guy's live and he's doing my request or whatever, and I wanna make sure I got time and energy to go and see that. But also, my dog needs to go outside or whatever. Interesting vibes. Take a look at that sloth one more time. Come on. Come on. technology. There we go. Kaya says, I have sloth everything. Yeah, you got like a bunch of sloth clothing items and sloth backpack and all that stuff. That's pretty cute. I like that. For everybody else, I mean, I'm pretty sure that Kaya's favorite animal is a sloth, but if you're watching the chat, what's your favorite animal? Do you have one? I mean, I know that's kind of hard because animals are so cool and all, but I think if I had a favorite animal, it would be ravens. I just am over the moon about ravens. I think ravens are so, they're clever, and they're pretty, and they're cryptic, curious. They're also rude. Which I think is sort of a side effect of being clever. Any animal that's capable of cleverness is capable of rudeness. And I find it very endearing, honestly. Personally. Me, personally. For my taste. I like when an animal is smart enough to be rude. You know? Sky Kid said, Dr. Dan! I kid. I am a bit like an animal, you know, sitting here in my, coming out of my cage, and I've been doing just fine. Sky Kid says, one of my faves is a wolf. I'd like one as a pet someday. Very good. Wolves seem like very noble animals. I don't know if you know this, but wolves and ravens actually have somewhat of a bond in the wild. They can actually hunt together because wolves hunt prey. Wolves are hunters. And ravens are scavengers, and so ravens will sometimes actually, because they're so clever, they will actually lead wolves to prey, because they know that the wolves are going to leave some left over that they can enjoy. When I found that out, I was like, that's a really cool bond thing, you know? Two animals that get along really well in the wild. Trisha Killian says, I'm all about wolves. Husband loves foxes, but we're also furries. Yeah, okay. Those are good animals for... We did a Dan Cakes challenge that I'm still kind of editing right now, a couple weeks ago, where me, Dana, and Ben, the three artists here at Dan Cakes, drew each other's... what we thought each other's personas would be, and I didn't understand... I clearly didn't understand the... what the difference between a fursona and a feathersona or something like that, you know, like I thought that it was just, oh, your animal entity. And so I drew Dana and Ben as things that don't have fur. I felt foolish afterwards, but foxes are very good. My wife is definitely partial to foxes. She grew up in the forests of Illinois, and she told me that she, like, She used to just hang out with foxes in the woods. I always thought that was really special, something really cool. Kaya says, I drew a sloth a few minutes ago. That's really cool. Do you draw often, Kaya? Entertainer, hey, over on Twitch. Is that a wild Jenny I see? Unless somebody else got that handle on Twitch, in which case, well, good for you. Artertainer is another one of the Dan Cakes artists, Jenny, over in California. We haven't done events for a while, and so I haven't gotten a chance to see Jenny in a while, which is kind of a bummer, but we still see each other online, and we're all the Dan Cakes people are, seems like we're all doing different forms of art and working to keep ourselves busy in all this. So, very good to hear from you, Jenny. Trisha Killian says, I would love to see one in person. Do you mean a fox? Are you responding to that I was talking about earlier? The foxes in the forest? Yeah, when my wife Hannah described, like, how, you know, like, being able to, like, hang out with foxes in the woods, like, baby foxes and stuff, I was like, that sounds crazy, man. That sounds so freaking crazy to me. Let's use some daring colors here for the sloth. Let's do some red. Some orange, or sorry, purple. This is not orange, this is purple. Don't know if y'all know colors. Do some orange stripes on the arms. I think the rest of it's gonna be purple. The face is gonna have a lot of orange in it, so that's sort of a lighter color. This sloth is just vibing. Just vibing. Very nice. All right. I'm gonna grab this white again and see if, because some of these lichens are white-colored. Kind of make a mess out of it, because that's how lichens kind of do. Excuse me. It's Samantha Polak on Facebook, did you accidentally copy and paste that message? Because if not, it's very cryptic to me. Trisha Killian says, the craziest animal I've ever held was a hummingbird. I rehabilitated it for a few days, low on sugar. It was beautiful to watch and fly away. Other than that, seagulls, who are very ungrateful and love to bite fingers, and dogs and cats. Seagulls do have a bit of a reputation, don't they? Mine. Hummingbird, though, that's really cool. I like looking into the, like in different cultures have different ideas of like what animals mean, like symbolically, you know? Like, so if you see an animal that you don't normally see, I find it's always really interesting to see. Like, if I see a raven sitting on a branch somewhere, like, it's kind of like a natural tarot card, sort of. And so I always like to look and see what different animals represent in different cultures. And I'm really curious what hummingbirds mean, because a couple days ago, when I was getting into my car before I drove to the studio to do some pancake artwork, as I was pulling out of my driveway, I looked to my right, and I saw, plain as day, a hummingbird just kind of floating there right next to my passenger window. And where my brain immediately went was, huh, I wonder what that means. I think it's really cool when you can pull some meaning in places like that. This tree is a bit of a mess. All the colors and shapes show up okay. My kid says, jump scare. Was there a jump scare? Did I miss something? Kaya says, I'm going to eat for 40 more minutes. To watch for 40 more minutes? Okay, I think I'll have time for one more pancake if you're sticking around for that. So cool. It'll be nice to have some more company. All right. So now I get to illustrate this sloth's rejuvenating vibes. Like I said, I associate the color green with rejuvenation. Maybe it's because of video games, you know? I think green is often like healing magic and health. I mean, health is usually red or green, one of the two. If I do this pattern right, then I should be able to trace these in such a way that they don't overlap too much. I get this really crazy, peculiar pop art effect. Look at those healing vibes. Look at those healing vibes. I feel healed already. Personally, I don't know about you, but I feel rejuvenated as heck. What's a good color to go against green? Probably. I'm going to use, I'll use yellow. It's close to green, so it doesn't really contrast with it. But we've already got those white lines back there, so really this is more of a complement than a contrast. And actually, I can whiffle out. I can do yellow, orange. Red. Oh, why not? We may as well keep going, yeah? Purple. Indigo. Blue. And we got a really nice little multicolor gradient there. All right. Sloth Rejuvenation. Paul Dunn on YouTube says, "Hi Dan, all your pancake art is amazing. I appreciate you saying so, Paul Dunn. I have been really trying to pull out all the stops lately. See if we can keep making content in light of all the craziness going on in the world. Because I really do love my job, and I would be very bummed if I had to go find other work. You know? I really hope the world gets its act together. I think there's a lot of good people out there that could be doing so much more with their time if things made more sense. One moment. Here we go. Oh, I'm gonna let that cook just a little bit longer. Back this pancake. Now that it's started to set a little bit, it'll be easier to. This one is one of the more dramatically colored ones I've done. So I hope it all turns out okay. I won't cook it too hot. Sky Kid on YouTube says, according to online sources, seeing a hummingbird can signify the enjoyment of life, lightness of being, playfulness, as well as adaptability. Well, that makes sense because I was driving to the studio to start doing live streams, trying to adapt. It's the joy of pancakes, the playfulness of life. Yeah, it's spooky. Trisha Killian on Facebook says, yes, I do that too as well. Look at angel numbers like 1111 or 1234. Yeah. Samantha Polak on Facebook says, I have donated for the sun and suitcase. Samantha, do you mean like the live stream request donations? Because we normally do that on Sunday. I'm concerned that like reading that, it sounds like you paid for something that this stream isn't made to make. And so if that's the case, just leave me a comment on the live stream chat and we'll sort it out. One way or another, you'll get a pancake from us, if that's what you're trying to do. If that is, in fact, what you're trying to do. Kaya says, love your videos. Thank you, Kaya. I really appreciate you being so sweet. Okay, Samantha, yeah, so Sundays at 3 p.m. Central Daylight Time is when we do the request live stream. So if you did send in a request, then that we'll get it taken care of then. This is the Joy of Pancakes stream, and this is something new we're trying. So it makes sense to, we haven't really been marketing this and making people aware of how it works. But mostly what I'm doing now is I'm taking prompts and trying to make them. I had a couple people comment in the stream earlier that said they wanted a sloth and they wanted the theme of rejuvenation. So that's what I'm making on the Joy of Pancakes here. The last one I made, the theme was freedom. Oh, no, it's okay, Samantha. And this was the one I made earlier. I was really, really happy with how this one turned out. I'm excited to preserve this one. And this one is Slothful Rejuvenation. Let's see here. This is going to take a little bit longer, but again, you never want to let it cook for too long, because the longer the pancake cooks, the more the colors start to brown. Kaya on YouTube asks, can you do Harry Potter next? Kaya, I am probably not going to do Harry Potter on Joy of Pancakes, just because I'm trying not to do branded stuff. I like doing things that I have a little bit more. I mean, I guess maybe I could do so. You know what? Actually, I will. I will, Kaya. I will do something Harry Potter related, but it's going to be something I don't have to look up, so it's not going to be a portrait or anything, okay? All right, 3, 2, 1. How cool is that? That's super psychedelic. I really love that. I'm really, really starting to enjoy the just kind of going nuts with the detail lines. Gosh, I feel like that's just... Okay. Yeah, that's lovely. One moment, everybody. Plate this. Thanks, everybody. Thanks for all the love you're showing me in the comment. Oh, and Artertainer Jenny over on Twitch. Yeah, you. I'm pretty sure you can watch this later. If it's not gonna be archived on Twitch, it will be archived on YouTube, and then we'll post it to the Dan Cakes website. So if you want to watch the drawing of the first one, my weird philosophical musings. Oh, let me make sure I'm showing the right camera. I've got the camera set to auto cycle. There's that. There's that. Oh. Yeah, I'm really, really happy with how these both turned out. They're great size, great colors. Gosh. Man. I got a cool job, everybody. Okay. For Kaya, I am going to do something Harry Potter related. Because I was sitting there and I was like, oh, I don't want to do branded stuff. And then I'm like, eh, what? It's not that I don't want to do branded stuff. It's that I don't want to do portraits and things that are really easy to mess up. So instead, what I'm going to do is I'm going to do a golden snitch. That's what I'm going to do. Yeah, it's just me in here right now, Jenny. I'm Jenny on Twitch said, I was wondering who was changing the cameras. We actually have OBS set up on our 4 studio cameras to just auto-cycle every 30 seconds. So that switch on the last pancake that flipped just in time, that was actually completely by mistake. So movie magic. Okay, golden snitch. And I have the cool thing about drawing something like a snitch is that it's a very basic shape and they're very ornate. But the core of a snitch is that it's a golden ball with little fluttering wings. I always thought that was a really cool thing. I mean, death of the author, but let's see here. All right. Yeah, the more I do these Joy Pancake streams and this particular style of pancake art, the more I really find that I really enjoy doing scenes. That makes sense. Doing little scenes and cutting off at the sides like I did on these, where you draw a background and you draw, the whole thing is filled. Okay. Let's see here. Lots of feather lines. Oh, Hannah Elston on YouTube. That's my wife. Hey, baby. Samantha Polak on Facebook. You've given me your email, and I just want to let you know that I'm seeing that, and I will be in touch so we can figure out what we're doing there. Appreciate you watching, and I appreciate you being a part of this. Okay, I want to do some feather lines. Very cute. Something else I like about this little design is it's gonna be very shiny, so it's gonna give me a lot of excuses to use really interesting highlights, if that makes sense. I'm trying to do a lot of these weird swirly shapes that I seem to recall. You know, you get this really ornate sort of pattern, wind pattern, just because. Okay. And I'm not quite sure I remember in the Harry Potter movies there's like a stadium where they play. I can't completely. It's hoops, isn't it? Isn't there? There's like three different hoops for scoring or something? I always thought that Quidditch was a very cool concept, like creatively. And even as I've gotten older and I'm really into game design now, especially fantasy game design. So I am a board game developer, and I spend a lot of time thinking about what makes a game fun and interesting and stand out. Because, when you really think about it, games are just these just totally arbitrary sets of rules. Like, hey, man, if you can get that rock to hit that thing, give you a dollar, or whatever. Like, at their core, they're very, very simple conceptually. Just rules is what it is, really. You just come up with some rules, a win condition, and I think that it is really a cool creative feat if somebody's able to come up with something that's really fantastic, but also believable. Like, it seems to work like a sport, you know? So I just thought that was pretty cool. This cool little piece. Pretty Bookworm on YouTube says, "The Joy of Pancakes is a great thing to watch to wind down after a tiring day." I'm so glad to hear you say that. I really appreciate that. The Noodle Princess on Twitch asks, "Board games? What kind of board games?" Right now, I am developing let me do some hills back here. Right now, I am developing a board game called Anthromancer. That is, I guess the genre would be, it is a neoclassical abstract strategy game, which easiest way to describe the way the game actually works is that it's like chess meets poker with just a tiny little sprinkle of like magic in there, just a little sprinkle. And it funded on Kickstarter a couple months ago, We're still developing it. Well, I mean, it's basically almost done with development, but we're still like putting the assets together to go and get it manufactured and stuff. I'm very, very excited about it. I've worked on it for half a decade. So, you know, like it's and it does a lot more than just games. Like there's multiple games you can play with it, and you know, that's something I'm very, very, very passionate about. And part of the creation process for me was studying the way that other games, oh, that did not go the way I wanted it to. Studying the way that other older games, like really, like chess, for instance, and poker, and figuring out how they do what they do, and trying to sort of build a game that borrows a lot of elements from old, timeless games, games that people still to this day play, even though nobody knows who made it. Like, I mean, chess is 700 years old. And decks of cards are, no, I think chess might be older than 700. It's cards that are like 700 years old. But it really fascinated me to learn how much history and culture there is in ancient games. And so I wanted my game to be sort of reminiscent of those. And I'm very, very proud of it. You can find out more about that on anthromancer.com if you're interested. Oh, Jenny, thank you. Jenny just dropped the link for you. That's very kind of you, Jenny. I appreciate you doing that. And also, a little bit back, Purple Anubis said that the background music is such a great addition to the stream. I appreciate you saying that, and I didn't want to let that comment go unaddressed. Noodle Princess says, "I like hearing you geek out." Yeah, if you keep watching Joy of Pancakes, you're gonna get a lot more of that because all I do is invent games, do pancake art, read weird old arcane books, eat hot chip and lie. So, eat hot chip and tell uncomfortable truth. Oh dear, that griddle turned on for a second, and so I'm gonna need to start highlighting these before it gets too late. Because if these lines cook too long or too hot, that was my mistake. That's a rookie move, Dan. Is this your first pancake? If they cook too hot, they have a tendency to peel, and so then they get covered up on your subsequent fills and stuff. So if I can go over them real quick and do some highlighting, but that can sometimes be enough to just hold those lines in place. But you know, our motto here at Dan Cakes is mistakes are delicious. Even if I do mess it up, it's okay. I already made two beautiful pieces that I'm sure somebody will want on their wall somewhere in the world, so it's not all a loss. I'm very excited to have some of the other artists come in and do stuff like this, like Dana and Ben are our in-town artists, my co-owners, and they haven't done any Joy Pancakes yet. And I think that the format here is such that like it's pretty simple, you know? Like obviously I draw pancakes in a certain way. I'm cultivating my own style here, and I'm sure they'll do it in their way. But like just take a prompt, spend 45 minutes drawing it. Straightforward stuff. This big empty sky is gonna give me a lot to work with as far as background colors, I think. I'm gonna outline all the stuff in the frame. Morgan Ray on Facebook says, "So you draw these with the griddle off?" Yes. Well, usually. I will, it's for the most part, like, it's as good as off. I only put that little qualifier in there just because sometimes I will add a little bit of heat to my griddle at the start of the process. And sometimes, even in the middle of the process, if it's a really, really long draw, I will turn the griddle on a little bit just because a little bit of heat will set your line work, right? It will make it so that it solidifies so that it doesn't, like when I put another layer of batter next to it doesn't bleed into each other because one of them's solid. So for the most part, the griddle's off. And when we teach people to do, especially when we teach kids to do pancake art for the first time, we usually emphasize to keep the griddle off because it makes it way, you have way less pressure on you, especially when you're starting out. But the mistake I made earlier in this process is that my griddle was a little bit on. And so we have the problem where, oops, those lines are gonna start peeling. I better fix that. Trisha on Facebook says, you just keep getting cooler and cooler the more you share about yourself. That's very sweet of you to say. I think one of the things that I'm most excited about doing the Joy of Pancakes more often with is just that I feel like I'll be honest, I like talking about myself. And I don't feel like that's a bad thing, you know? Like, I have always, my favorite part of this job in the past up to this point has been, like, whenever I get the chance to go be on TV and talk about how I got here or talk about my pancake art story or all that stuff. Because, I mean, ever since I was a little kid, like, my stepmom and my dad actually have home movies lying around somewhere of me in the Three Little Pigs opera wearing all, you know, the little pig makeup. I think I was in preschool. This was like the very first time I'd ever been on a stage. And I was the smartass who had memorized all the other kids' lines and was reciting all of their lines with them. So you can watch this video of me just like, because they're, I mean, you know, they're freaking preschoolers. Not everybody remembered all their lines, but I did. So I was trying to help, but also I was showing off, you know? Like, I was too young to realize that's what I was doing, but that's totally what I was doing. So that's just kind of who I am. Who I am as a person. I like to show off. And so far, I mean, it has served me pretty well. I make breakfast art for a living, so that's cool. I mean, I've also had to learn to check my ego. Like, it hasn't all been, you know, bread and roses or whatever. You need to see the three little pigs orchestra. Yeah. One of these days, I will have my stepmom help me archive that digitally. And we will check the tape together. Since that background's maybe really... Okay. What am I going to do about these mountains? I'm going to hurl them into the sun. Oh, right. I do want to have some clouds and stuff back here. Just a little bit of visual intrigue. I like these cloud shapes. They're just sort of like fat lines. Very stylized. The Simpsons. Thin lines too to add some interesting texture. Okay. Katie Sullivan says, in my preschool production, I found out that there were strings I could pull on my costume and had to take my whole costume off piece by piece by the end of the production. That's showbiz, kid. I'll have to share that video with you sometime, Willa. Trisha Killian asks, does your wife do pancakes with you? No, she does not. She picks me up from my pancake job. She's a very business-minded woman. She writes. She's an amazing cook. But she does not do pancake art with me. She leaves that to me. I am her personal pancake jester, I guess. Let's see here. Okay. Still gotta make some choices. I hate making choices. What I'm gonna do is I'm gonna use black here to create some darker shadows on the bases of these mountains. Some nice harsh contrast. And we're going to use blue for the mountains themselves, since I'm not going to be using this in the sky, really. And then I'm going to use a couple little drops of yellow for some texture. And the grass, the lawn, right? The field. And if you watched earlier in the stream, you would have seen that I stumbled into a cool little trick that I was not expecting to work the way it did. That I can simulate wildflowers. I just do them little color zones like this. Little pockets of flowers. And so then when I fill everything else over here in green, I'll get the base of those. I fill all that in with green. If it works the way it did last time, it'll look like flowers on the field. Which I'm sure that the groundskeeper probably wouldn't let flowers get on the field, but I don't care. My art. I'm going to do it my way. We are going to do... Let me try and draw straight across here if I can. So what I'm going to start doing is I'm going to do a gradient. This gradient here. I'm going to do these sunset colors up to the top. Fatten that a little bit just so I can have some red peeking out over the top of the snitch there. Purple. Fat band of indigo. A little bit wider, and I think at the very, very top, I'm gonna go a little silly here. I'm gonna do a couple little stars. I'm gonna fill that in with black. Like it's dusk, you know? A golden sneech at dusk. Okay. Turn that on. I'm gonna outline this whole thing in white. Wing sticking out there makes it look like it's popping out of the frame. And this is going to be my last pancake for the stream. Hannah, my wife, is actually outside waiting for me, and we're gonna go spend time together after this. Let's see, I've got some comments over here. This Sky Kid on YouTube says, I'd want you to act in a project one day, Dr. Dan. Just got to get recognized first for your voice work. Yeah, absolutely. And you know I would be all about that, Sky Kid. You've been one of our biggest fans for so long. It's the least I can do. Kaya says, can you do an owl? I can, Kaya, but this is going to be the last pancake I do on this particular stream. I will be doing the Joy of Pancakes, so this sort of long-form video style, again on Monday at 3 p.m. Central Daylight Time, so the same time, in a couple days. And we are going to do, I'm not sure if it'll be me, I'm going to see if I can convince one of the other artists to do it since I don't normally come in on Fridays. But we always do a request live stream on Sunday afternoons at 3 p.m. CDT. So you can come back to the same spot, and those work a little different where we actually are making as many pancakes as we can for people in chat and people that give us donations online and stuff. So if you really want me to make that aisle for you, you can come in through on that day. What else we got? Katie Sullivan says, oh, Katie Sullivan on YouTube. And of course, after each piece I took off, I walked off stage and handed it to my teacher and then went back. At one point in the video, you can see her frantically gesturing, trying to get me to stay. And also Hannah on YouTube says, you don't even like hot chip, you liar. Trisha on Facebook asks, do y'all have pets? Hannah and I do have one pet. We have a gray sphinx named Fib. Or fibbing. He's very, very small, very wrinkly, very handsome, and very, very, very affectionate. We both love him very much, and all he does is lie about whether or not he has been given food, so we call him fibbing. Katie Sullivan asks, what was the prompt for this pancake? Somebody from the chat asked me to do something Harry Potter related. Kaya, over on YouTube, I believe, asked me to do something Harry Potter related, and my impulse was to say no, because I don't want to do branded stuff. But I think my resistance is more because I don't want to do portraits of people, I want to do scenes. And so, I decided on second thought that I was like, you know what, Kaya's been hanging out, been very sweet in the chat, I'm going to go ahead and use that prompt. I will do a golden snitch. If I can think of something really that I think would work really well in the particular style I'm doing, I'm probably more likely to pick that from the chat. Yeah, I'm figuring this thing out as I go, you know, like, and we'll have the other artists in here doing it from time to time. Next Joy Pancakes is going to be Monday, 3 p.m. CDT. We're going to have the chill music playing. We're going to have, I don't know what the prompt will be. The first prompt today was freedom because it was September 11th, and I wanted to sort of kind of lean into that a little bit, but not too much. The second one was a rejuvenating sloth. So I've got these sitting off to the side here. I'll show you all that before we sign off completely. And this one was a snitch, a golden snitch from Harry Potter. So just kind of winging it, you know, doing what I can here and there to just have fun with people. I've really enjoyed this so far, you know. I'm hoping that we can continue to do these for a long time and get more people excited about coming to check them out, more word of mouth stuff, just so that we have a bigger audience. And all the pancakes that I'm making right now, we will be preserving these. We are going to freeze dry them, and we are going to frame them, and eventually, however long it takes us to make these, you're going to be seeing them hanging behind me while I do these. So they will probably be, we're either going to sell them at a flat rate or auction them. I think we'll probably end up auctioning them just so that it's not like a first come, first serve thing. It's, if you really, really want the piece, you can outbid other people. I might be trying to flip this too soon. It's tearing up a little bit. That's okay. After this pancake, what I'm going to do is I'm going to move the griddle out of the way, and I'll bring the other two pancakes that I made on the stream and set them all next to each other, and I'll sign off. I'll thank you all for watching and all that stuff. If you would like to, well, I guess I kind of have to, got to sell stuff to you. If you want to do what I'm doing here, if you want to do pancake art the way I do it here at Dan Cakes, all the tools that I used in this video, the griddle, the spatula, and basically everything except the plates, you can get on the Dan Cakes website. We sell the gel colors for adding color to your pancake batter. We sell the plastic bottles, and the pancake art kit itself includes the griddle, the spatula, the fill bottle, and these larger batter pens over here, the ones that actually have our logo on them. All that stuff you can get on the Dan Cakes website. We also do commissions. So if you want me to make a preserved pancake for you of somebody in your life, or a loved one, or a birthday, or an anniversary present that's coming up, Those, we totally do that, and we've been selling more of those. It's my favorite thing to do. I'm gonna stop talking for a second and flip this real quick. Well, let me come over here. And... yeah, here we go. 3, 2, 1. Wow. Those colors stayed true. Yeah. Fantastic. I'm really, really happy with how that turned out. It's a little bit less busy than the other two, but I think it still works really nicely. The colors are very even. Yeah, I think that's super cool. Somebody will like that, I'm sure. That was a good request, Kaya. Okay. So right, as I was saying, got stuff, we got services, we got products, we got everything. And yeah, if you want me to make a really elaborate, you know, because I mean, some of the ones you see behind us, these can take 40, 50. I know Dana spent like 4 hours mixing colors for her beast pancake over there. So we're very flexible, and we try and really knock it out of the park on every pancake we make. So if you would like to commission us, we would love to hear from you. The Preserved Pancakes commissions, they usually run $200 is the low end, just so y'all know. But it's the resin and the frame building. You know, we build the frames, we stain the frames, we do the whole, it's a, this whole craft process. We got a freeze dryer, all that stuff. I shall dance. I'm going to move this griddle out of the way so y'all can see the roundup of the pancakes I made on this particular episode. And yeah. Oh yeah, we also do digital events, live streams, private classes, and we are going to be rolling out a patron program. So if you would like to help us continue to do this, because I really love doing it, what I really want to try and do is start a patron program so that we can have, you know, if 1,000 of our followers gave us $5 a month or something cheap like that, we would be in a much better position to continue to do this. And I think that's reasonable. Switch over to this overhead camera here. So for the roundup, we have Freedom, which I kind of wanted to do a nature scene. I was really drawing on my experiences in Yellowstone Park with Hannah, who's watching in the YouTube. Rejuvenation and a sloth that was rejuvenating. I tried to give him healing vibes. And a Harry Potter snitch. And so that is the Joy of Pancakes. All right, everyone. I will be back in the studio on Monday at 3 p.m. CDT to do another Joy of Pancakes just like this, where you can give me your prompts, and we will make these beautiful pancakes for you, engage with you in the chat. It's really, really special to me that we get to hang out like this. I honestly, it's been super good for my mental health just to not, rather than editing all this stuff in isolation, hunched over a computer, I can just hang out with cool people and make pancake art. Like, it's so much better to do it live like this. It's so much easier for me. And our Sunday live stream at 3 p.m. CDT, where you can actually do lots and lots of requests. So thank you so much, everyone, for watching, and I will see you around. Remember, mistakes are delicious. I gotta get somebody to switch to the wide camera for when I say this stuff. Hold on a second. There you go. Remember, mistakes are delicious. See you around, guys.